Dark life. First life in the universe? Stars are the lifeblood of the universe. Their energy provides heat, which drives the processes necessary for life to exist. They create planets. They create elements. We humans are literally made from molecules fused in the very core of a star. But are stars the only way of creating life? Perhaps not. So let's find out how else it might be done as we explore dark life, first life in the universe. Number 4. Habitable zones. According to our current understanding of how life emerges on barren worlds, living things can be rather fussy about the conditions they're prepared to accept. To begin with, their planet must have liquid water to allow the chemistry of life to work its magic. To fulfill this criterion, you'll need somewhere with a surface temperature of around 300 Kelvin or 26.85 Celsius. And since planets don't have a giant thermostat hidden in a cupboard under the stairs, the only way to achieve this is by having a planet which orbits at a certain proximity to its parent star. Or is it? For decades, cosmologists have been searching for life-sustaining planets by looking within the habitable zone of stars, also known as the Goldilocks zone. This is an orbital area neither too distant nor too close to a star, with this balance allowing surface temperatures to remain around the 300 Kelvin required for liquid water. But stars aren't the only source of heat in the universe. In our recent video, Dark Stars, we explored how planets orbiting black holes may also be able to support life. In this instance, there would be an equivalent Goldilocks zone surrounding the black hole, which would represent the only place life could exist. But are habitable zones all that special? Does a planet need to orbit a heat-giving object to sustain water-suitable temperatures? Apparently not. Because at one point in the history of the cosmos, this habitable zone may have comprised our entire universe. Stick that in your pipe, Goldilocks, you porridge-stealing weirdo. Number 3. The CMB. Abraham Loeb is an American theoretical scientist who believes life may have existed 10 to 17 million years after the Big Bang. Loeb of Harvard University says that in the afterglow of the Big Bang, the conditions were ripe for alien life to have sprung into existence. The early universe was full of superheated gas, which eventually cooled and condensed to form stars and galaxies. We can see the first light emitted by this gas in the form of the cosmic microwave background. Today, the temperature of the CMB is just slightly above absolute zero. But between 10 and 17 million years after the Big Bang, the temperature would have been closer to the 300 Kelvin required for liquid water to exist on early rocky worlds. Loeb's calculations can be found in his paper, The Habitable Epoch of the Early Universe, in which he also explains how rocky planets might have formed in the densest parts of our universe. The building blocks of life on Earth are elements like carbon and metals, and these reportedly only came into existence once the earliest stars started dying in massive supernovas 150 to 1 billion years after the Big Bang. Loeb's theory is that huge stars many times larger than our Sun formed and died out quickly during the earliest times of the universe, with their destruction helping create the heavier elements needed to form planets and life before we previously thought. In an interview with Slate, Loeb expanded on his findings to suggest that the worlds on which these life forms existed would have been protected from asteroid bombardment and some of the more dangerous forms of cosmic radiation due to their isolation. Unfortunately, any life on these planets wouldn't have had much time to evolve thermal underwear before the temperature of the universe lowered so much as to drastically alter their environment. So, could an organism have survived this event? Number 2. Adapt or die. Scientists have responded to Abraham Loeb's idea of an early habitable universe with mixed emotions. Freeman Dyson, the world-famous physicist at the Institute for Advanced Study at Princeton, thinks the adaptability of life should not be underestimated, having been quoted as saying that Anything is habitable if you are clever enough. Let's put Mr. Dyson inside a pizza oven for 3 days and see if he still thinks that. Conversely, some cosmologists have contended that complex life would have no chance of existing upon such worlds, since a few million years is far too short a time to produce it. Abraham Loeb agreed with this sentiment in the aforementioned interview with Slate, stating that early universe life forms would have been very simple organisms like algae. Within a million years, this algae would have to adapt to cooler temperatures or face extinction. However, as Freeman Dyson says, this isn't an impossibility. In fact, when you consider that many worlds would have been rendered habitable by the existence of a warm universe, the chances of adaptable life existing on some of them increases significantly. We can boost these chances even further if we consider that climate change and internal heat retention may have helped these planets stay warm long after the CMB cooled. In Loeb's paper, he was quoted as saying, "Thermal gradients are needed for life. These can be supplied by geological variations on the surface of rocky planets. These internal heat sources, in addition to possible heating by a nearby star, may have kept planets warm even without the redshifted CMB, extending the habitable epoch." With regards to climate change, Loeb has noted that a process known as collision-induced absorption may have allowed molecular hydrogen within the atmosphere of early planets to act as a greenhouse gas. How? Collision-induced absorption. Yes, collision-induced absorption. We prefer the fancy words here at Strange Mysteries because they make us look smart. Usually, when two molecules of hydrogen or any gas collide into each other, they bounce apart. Imagine two very large people running into each other and then bouncing backwards after they collide. Now imagine two very large people running into each other and then sticking together in a lover's embrace instead of bouncing away. That's collision-induced absorption. When collision-induced absorption occurs with hydrogen in this way, it becomes supramolecular. And being in that state allows it to do some pretty crazy stuff. Hydrogen acts like a completely different molecule in this state. But it's still hydrogen. One of its new special abilities in supramolecular form is being able to act as a greenhouse gas. Now, collision-induced absorption tends to occur only in certain conditions. One of those is being blasted with microwaves. Seeing as there is cosmic microwave background radiation warming the entire universe, collision-induced absorption easily occurs on any planets that, for whatever reason, have hydrogen on them. Loeb goes on to mention how a blanket of molecular hydrogen may also have helped extend the habitability of these early worlds, basing this assessment on Pierre Humbert and Guidos' 2011 paper, Hydrogen Greenhouse Planets Beyond the Habitable Zone. This study was intended to show how the habitable zone of ordinary stars could be extended if a planet's atmosphere was composed of supramolecular hydrogen. But it unwittingly extends the habitable period in Loeb's paper, too. So, if there were many planets teeming with simple life all on different worlds in the early universe, how might this have translated towards intelligent life? Number 1. Gaia. In one of our recent videos, The Gaia Hypothesis, we explored the theory that life works as part of a feedback loop with the environment in which it develops. In the context of the early habitable universe hypothesis, the most relevant link is that between microorganisms and Earth's temperature. According to the Gaia-based claw hypothesis, organisms whose biological processes help cool the planet have been seen to evolve when Earth has been too warm. Vice versa, organisms which help warm the planet evolved whenever Earth began to get too cold. Essentially, these organisms evolved to adapt to their environment, and the environment adapted to them. If Gaia is true, Loeb's young habitable universe becomes even more likely. The young organisms born on those early rocky worlds should have evolved in a way which made their environment more habitable and thus helped to raise its temperature. This is made more likely by the findings Gaia's proponents made through their simulation of a planet called Daisy World. Having modeled a biosystem containing variant numbers of organisms, Daisy World's creators discovered that the presence of many different species helps a planet become habitable much quicker. But surely, this is bad news for Loeb's theory, is it not? Since the short time frame he proposes gives little chance for a wide variety of species to emerge. This is true. However, that would only be the case on one single planet. In Loeb's paper, he argues that if life persisted during this time, it could have been transported to newly formed objects through panspermia. Now, remember, the universe at this time was much smaller. These early worlds, while still far apart, would have been much closer than Earth is to distant star systems today. Panspermia, the exchange of microorganic life through the cosmos via meteors and asteroids, would have been far easier and more likely when the universe was smaller. Thus, if the Gaia hypothesis is correct, many forms of simple life could have spread throughout the early habitable universe and subsequently helped more and more planets sustain habitability for a far longer period. Eventually, some of this may have evolved, as it did on Earth, into complex and intelligent life. But enough about the early universe. What about the future? Can life survive in our solar system when our sun goes crazy and burns up the Earth? Sure it can. And we're going to explore this in our bonus video, Mankind's Successors, which you can watch on our Patreon page at patreon.com/strangemysteries. For a $2 a month pledge, which you can cancel at any time, you'll get to watch this and all of our bonus content, which goes deeper and darker into every topic than YouTube allows. If you don't want to donate, then...
Bullshit. We know you wanted more. Strange Mysteries on YouTube and our Patreon bonus videos weren't enough to quench your search for truth, to give you that sense of awe and wonder again, to go past what you thought was the end, to give you the answers you seek, but which only lead to more questions. That's why we just upped the stakes. Chemicals of reality. Reality, consciousness, brains. What else is there? Ask yourself that question. Perhaps that's all there really is. But perhaps everything else is found within a place where these ideas, these things, overlap. Some thing, some place that is undefinable. To many people, altering certain chemicals in their brains produces what they would simply call hallucinations. In fact, what we're going to discuss specifically used to be called the businessman's trip, as one could enjoy it. Come down and put your pants back on in the time it takes to eat lunch. It wasn't taken seriously. Well, unless, of course, you started digging. And some people, including us, did. Already, though, to many people, this chemical is special amongst others. Very special. To them, it represents something more meaningful and incredible, as if it's the gateway to the next level of consciousness. The ticket to a higher reality barely explored by most humans. It is the entry point to a new reality, visited by only a select few, whose minds have become enlightened through the use of this exotic substance. For this reason, it's commonly referred to as the spirit molecule. But is its reputation as a mystical mind opener deserved? Or is it and everything it represents just a load of bullshit? We look at, investigate, and dive deeply into nearly all available research regarding this question from nearly every angle feasible. And in the course of doing so, stumble upon unexplainable patterns, correlations, and neurological evidence for a reality existing beyond this one. Watch this hour-long Strange Mysteries premium video, Chemicals of Reality, as well as many more to come by becoming an elite premium member of our Patreon at patreon.com/strangemysteries.